production funding for Ruckus has been provided by Fred and Lou Hartwig and viewers like you. Thank you.
Welcome to Ruckus, our weekly food for thought fight over the news of the day and the trends of the times. I'm Mike Shanin. The Ruckettes join me shortly. Our topics tonight: why did Mitt quit? What about Hillary and Claire adding Kander to the Missouri Senate race and adding $1 billion downtown, plus roast and toast? But we start with our newsmaker interview. Campaign's already underway for the Kansas City, Missouri City Council, about 40 people running for council and mayor. The primary is in April and the general election in June. To talk about what running for office is like and what voters should be watching for is a two-term council veteran who will be leaving office once the new council is installed. Cindy Circo was elected at large from the 5th District in 2007 and has served as mayor pro tem since 2011. Cindy Circo, welcome to the Ruckus program. Good to have you with us.
Happy to be here. Thank you.
Once you leave office this summer, what do you think you're going to miss most about being on the city council?
I love the diversity of the job. You can go from just helping someone with a tree that's lift up their sidewalk to a major development deal, all within the same hour. So it changes dramatically all day long, and I love that diversity of being able to interact at every level.
What will you miss least about being on the city council?
What I miss least will be probably grandstanding or rhetoric. I get really frustrated when people use rhetoric to try to make their point when there's so many facts to lean on either side of any piece of information or issue that you're trying to debate.
Talking about rhetoric from other members of the city council?
That happens, or even
the news media?
Or news media, whichever way. But yeah, that's probably one of my pet peeves, is
now,
rhetoric.
You've run for office twice, been successful both times, but before you ran the first time for the city council, you never looked for elective office before, right?
I had not. I grew up in a political family, so I really thought I would never run. I thought I should know better than to put your life out there so publicly. But it really is a calling. It is one of those jobs that's a calling, like a police officer or a firefighter. It's something you're passionate about and something you want to be engaged with helping. And it did start with being involved in other committees. I was on PIAC, involved in school issues with my children, church issues. So you just find your personality leads you down that path.
I would think it would be very difficult to run for office what you experience day after day, the constant criticism, the constant attention.
You have to be able to adjust to all of that. It can take you down or make you feel more self-important. So my mother's advice very early on was to grow and not swell. And I keep that in mind all the time when I have people telling me how great I am. What is the purpose, and why am I here, and what am I learning from this?
Well, we hope a lot of the people who are running for city council watch Ruckus, and I suspect they'd be very interested in what tips you can give them, particularly those who are running for the first time. What kind of advice would you give would-be members of the Kansas City, Missouri Council?
Well, it's very hard not to take attacks or other people's opinions personally, but you can't. You have to make sure that you're very grounded in what you think you're doing and your beliefs. Know that you don't know a lot until you get in there, so don't make big promises that you can't come in and deliver. But have that mindset that you're willing to work hard, find the facts, and then work at delivering those objectives. I think that if you're willing to put in the boots on the ground work and a date, and that's a 24/7 job is campaigning, and you have to be willing to give it that.
All right, what would you tell voters who are watching this campaign, we assume, and paying attention to the various candidates? What should voters look for in prospective city council members?
First of all, I want to encourage people in Kansas City to actually vote. Our voting percentages are very low, and we can make a huge difference in Kansas City when we actually do vote. Beyond that, ask the hard questions at these candidate forums. The rhetoric, again, is really easy to do in short snippets of time. But ask them to go a little bit deeper and look for those people that are going to be building consensus and are willing to devote the real time that it takes to be a council person.
What's a typical day like on the city council?
You know, I can spend anywhere from 60 to 70 hours, excuse me, a week dealing with council issues and conference calls, even if I'm not in the office. But Wednesdays and Thursdays are our committee days, and then our business session and legislative session. So you walk in that door, people are wanting to meet with you. They want to advocate for their issues. You are in committees hearing ordinances and legislation that can have some long debates, and you have to make some hard decisions.
What do you consider your biggest success on the city council during your tenure?
I think my biggest success has been able to connect the dots, having relationships and building relationships and remembering that someone a year or two before had said something that then connects to an opportunity a year or so later. I've been very fortunate to be engaged in some really large projects like Google. We can debate the streetcar all day long, but that was led by Russ Johnson, but it was something I believed and saw the economic development happening across the nation. You just find those connections. Swope Park Village was a conglomerate of people wanting the same thing but at different times and getting them all on the same page to move forward. So it's just really being able to be that convener.
The primary election is coming up in April, the general election in June. Cindy Circo, thank you very much. Appreciate your time here.
Thank you.
Kansas City, Missouri City Councilwoman and Mayor Pro Tem Cindy Circo. Now let's go over and meet the panel and start a ruckus. Yael Abouhalkah is an editorial writer at the Kansas City Star. Gwen Grant is president and CEO of the Urban League in Kansas City. Steve Glorioso is a prominent local political consultant. And Crosby Kemper III is CEO of the Kansas City Library System and host of KCPT's Meet the Past program. In what might be a slightly tongue-in-cheek column, the Star's editorial page editor, Steve Paul, contemplates the possibility of Senator Claire McCaskill following in the footsteps of Harry Truman from the Senate to the White House. Paul wonders if Democrats would turn to McCaskill if, for some reason, Hillary doesn't run. And the editor also wonders if this thought has perhaps occurred to McCaskill, citing a steady stream of news releases from her office, 6 in one day last week. All seem to highlight her Truman-esque policy and political views. Paul concedes this might all be idle speculation were it not for this Rachel Maddow interview with the senator on the same day as the news releases.
I know you are completely committed to Hillary Clinton and her run for the presidency in 2016. If for some reason she decides not to run, would you consider running?
You know, I doubt it.
Steve Paul doesn't seem to take McCaskill's response seriously. Do you think we should, Gwen?
No. I don't think you should take any politician's response seriously when they are in the media. And as Claire was, you would not dare give a straight yes or no answer to that question because you never know in politics. Anything could happen. But I think it would be pretty ironic if Claire were to throw her hat into the ring for a presidential race after stepping out of the race for the governor of Missouri, especially if the speculations that her polling was not that great, was not great enough to be elected governor of Missouri, to think that you cannot now be elected president of the United States might be a stretch. So I think it would be ironic, but stranger things have happened. Strange things happen in politics every day.
Steve, I can see you as the James Carville of the McCaskill administration.
I tried to get my hair cut short enough to qualify as that. Well, I don't think she's thinking of running for president, but she is up for re-election, and now she's pretty much decided to run another term. She has a book coming out in about 3 months. I've talked to Claire a couple of times about it, and I actually did an interview with her biographer, and evidently it's going to be a tell-all kind of book, and I think the reaction to the book could set the stage for what she does next. And, you know, let's say Hillary doesn't run and there's a male candidate, O'Malley, my pick would be John Kerry. You know, Claire would be a suitable, looked upon favorably maybe as a VP candidate. But I think she's really aiming for re-election, and that's what Steve Paul's reacting to.
What do you think, Yael?
John Kerry?
Yeah.
Okay. First of all, I'm a Claire McCaskill fan, even though she's been upset with me a number of times in recent years.
Who hasn't?
That's true. That's a good point. But I think she's whippet smart. Politics, obviously she got lucky with the Aiken thing in red year and all that kind of stuff. But I think she's very smart. I think she does have the best interest of the state in general at hand. I mean, she'll take some conservative positions. She takes liberal positions. Now, a lot of people think that's a flip-flop, but I think some of that is how she actually evaluates some of these issues. So I like her.
Got to move on. After losing the 2012 presidential race, Mitt Romney said this was his last run for the White House. Then a couple of weeks ago, he seemed to change his mind and appeared ready to try a third time for the GOP nomination. Last week, however, he changed his mind again and said he would not run. So, Steve, why did Mitt quit?
Couldn't win. I mean, he was like leftover toast, or something. I don't have a good analogy, but, you know, I think in his soul, he's a decent fella, and I think he really thought he could be a good president. And, you know, he came close, or he thought he was going to come close the last time, and he didn't, and wanted to run again. And the party just said, no, your time has passed.
Well, Crosby, when he was talking about not running back after the election, everybody said, oh, no, you need to try it again. And he got a lot of encouragement. When he finally started indicating that he might run again, then those people who encouraged him seemed to turn against him.
Well, two things are true. One, you have to have the fire, and that's one reason yeah. Claire won't run, and it's a reason that Mitt won't run. He also ran a terrible campaign, and there's sort of a general realization of that dawning in the Republican Party.
All right, we'll move ahead. In all candor, and to be perfectly blunt, it looks as if the teleprompter is not. It looks as if the current Missouri Secretary of State wants to take on a sitting U.S. Senator in next year's election. The Secretary of State is Kansas Cityan Jason Kander, who previously served in the Missouri House. The Senator is Roy Blunt, who also once served as the Missouri Secretary of State. As you likely know, Kander is a Democrat, Blunt a Republican. Kander at 33 is the youngest statewide elected official in America. Crosby, would this be an uphill battle for Kander if he perhaps becomes the Democratic nominee?
Yeah, I don't think he could beat Roy Blunt. I think also Jason needs to get some seasoning. I'm a librarian, and he is my boss at the state level, and he's completely lost his constituency of librarians by failing to defend the library part of the state budget.
And has overdue fines.
he might run using the Jay Nixon model of running and running and running and running and running until you finally get it. But I think actually this is one he's smart enough that I think he probably won't take this on.
33 is pretty young to be running for the U.S. Senate. Not impossible,
well,
but it's...
I don't think that age is as big an issue as seasoning. You know, age has nothing to do with it. I think it's the experience you get and how well quickly you learn in those roles. But I agree with you, Crosby. Blunt has no issues. I mean, he's in a crimson state and he's got money in the bank. I mean, he's got, you know, over $1 million in his war chest. And I think he's, it would not be wise to get in that race. You're going to lose. It's seriously an uphill battle.
Yeah, what do you know about Kander? Have you dealt with him on any of these issues?
Not much at all. I mean, I haven't.
He's like a superstar, though, isn't he?
Oh, he is. I mean, I think he's certainly, as maybe incorrect as he might be in some of the library stuff, he's absolutely correct on a lot of the voting stuff, encouraging voting, making voting open to a lot of appeal. I think Crosby said he seems to be like a pretty smart guy, and I think eventually he will be smart enough to realize, well, you're not going to beat Blunt right now, so, you know, wait around. He may go to another office. He may do something else.
Yeah.
What are Blunt's liabilities?
He's a
Republican?
He's a knuckle-dragging Republican. In Missouri, that's a high quality.
The Blunt name's been around in Missouri politics for quite a while.
Yeah. And Roy has a lot of positives. He's a knuckle-dragging Republican.
There you go. and we all agree.
We all agree on that, absolutely. And he's a smart politician.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's remarkable. He's doing it the Kit Bond way. He's doing little bitty things, like, you know, Bond, it wasn't little, but Bond championed a lot of money for public housing, and he peeled off part of a Democratic constituency. Blunt does things like sponsoring Jane Chu to be the head of National Endowment for the Arts. And you know, he does these little, he's about as good a politician as I've seen.
He works well across party lines.
That's good.
All right, also in Missouri politics, another candidate is joining the race for the GOP gubernatorial nomination. It's Tom Schweich, the state auditor, who will likely face former Missouri House Speaker and U.S. Attorney Catherine Hanaway, who is backed by controversial St. Louis businessman Rex Singfield. Crosby, how do you see this one shaping up?
Well, my friend Rex and I are on opposite sides of this one. He's going to give $1 million to Catherine Hanaway. I'm giving $100 to Tom Schweich. And so show me is going to be on both sides of this issue. We have three really smart, tough candidates in this race, Chris Koster on the Democratic side, and both Tom Schweich and Catherine Hanaway. They're smart people. They're tough people. Catherine Hanaway will be the next governor of the state of Missouri. She's tougher even than Chris Koster, and she will raise more money and appeal to more of the base of the Republican Party. I'm supporting Tom Schweich because I think he's a really honorable guy, and we do have some problems with corruption in the state of Missouri.
That's his big campaign issue, is it not, to try to overcome whatever corruption exists?
But Catherine Hanaway will be the next governor.
You agree with that, Steve?
Yeah,
Catherine Hanaway is about to be governor?
You don't win a party primary attacking the party.
Right.
Now, I do agree with Schweich. I mean, there is this thing about lobbyists and gifts and you know, Rex basically putting Hanaway on his payroll, but it's not going to endear him to the base of the Republican Party.
What do you think, Claire?
Well, I think Schweich, he came out swinging, and I thought it was impressive in that he is positioning himself so that I think he will be of interest to the more moderate Republicans, and I think that was really important as to why he did that. Now, Crosby, with regard to Koster and Hanaway, I think it will be certainly a brawl, but never count Koster out either. He's a really tough adversary.
That should be a good race, should it not? Hanaway?
Well, yeah, if it gets to be that
it gets
way.
To be that.
I do agree with Crosby. I like a lot of what Schweich says, but I would ought to remind everybody, it's February 2015, the election, the primaries in August of 2016. A lot can happen.
You will like what Schweich says. He wants to keep the Republican Party from becoming the Rex Republican Party.
Yes.
On that issue, it does have to be said, the star keeps referring to the billionaire Rex Singfield.
Millionaire, multimillionaire.
Billionaire Rex Singfield. And I don't see any epithets about Sam Fox, who has given a lot of money to Schweich, and I'm supporting Schweich.
Barb Shelley mentioned that in her column last time, as I recall.
I think Barb Shelley said there was no major contributor to Tom Schweich.
Schweich makes the point there's no one major contributor to his campaign.
$500,000.
To be real clear, Rex is in a league of himself. When you introduce him as a controversial, he's only controversial because he decides to give big, big, big checks to people that, who he says, think the way I think. Well, why do you think the way Rex thinks? Because you're going to get money.
Well, he's also controversial because of statewide proposals he's made, what he wants to do about education, what he wants to do about taxes.
Yeah. But he's only controversial because he has money.
Oh, that's
why he got things. Well, oh, yes, it is true.
He would not be listened to at all.
Glorioso is controversial. He doesn't have any money.
There aren't people on that side of the issue, Yael?
Of course there are, but why is he listened to? Because he funds your group, right?
Well, lots of people fund our group.
More than $100, probably,
about.
Yes.
Yeah, I know. There are lots of people. He provides about a third.
One person providing a third of a major organization.
Your group is the Show Me Institute.
My point about this is there are lots of people with a lot of money in this state, and he's the only one who gets the ep of that. He's the only one who gets your attention on this.
Well,
There are a lot of people who spend tens of millions of dollars, but you never talk about the people on the other side.
He paid for that attention.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, no one gives as much money as he does. I mean,
there's some people over time who've given plenty of money.
We're going to move ahead.
Kansas
City Business Customer Service Center, also known as BizCare, told the Business Journal that more than $1 billion has been invested in downtown public and private development projects since voters approved the 2-mile starter streetcar system in late 2012. Streetcar authority officials say this is a clear sign that the planned system is spurring economic development. Agree with that assessment, Yael?
Well, I mean, we've kind of been down this track before, and obviously, and Crosby's point is out, I think Steve and I talked about it too, that you cannot attribute everything that's happening in downtown Kansas City to the streetcar. I mean, there's a lot of good stuff happening in downtown Kansas City, and some of it is happening without incentives, which is actually unbelievable. It is stunning. It can happen. I would also very quickly say that downtown is still one of those areas that gets subsidies for some of these projects because all the damn suburbs are giving subsidies. Now here's the thing that you be more pro streetcar. Did you notice that there's actually investment going on downtown along the streetcar line. Actually, streetcar has not killed things, as some of the opponents said. Opponents said, well, you know, restaurant's going to go up and die. There's nothing going to happen along the streetcar. It's not going to be any good at all. So what I hope everybody recognizes is it's February 2015. In February 2016, the streetcar will be operating. The streets will be smooth. Things will be opening. And yes, we probably will be talking about extending it south down Main. That's what I really think is going to happen. That's where the next big debate is.
There's no economic development from the streetcar, and you know, we've been subsidizing things, including Power and Light District and Sprint Arena, and then of course every real estate development that comes down the pike over the last 20 years. And what's the result of that? We have 20,000 fewer jobs in downtown Kansas City. So, our economic development policy is terrible. A streetcar is not going to help economic development. It is incredibly expensive. It's the most expensive per mile in the United States. And it's a bad idea. However, I'm going to ride it, and I'm looking forward to the fantasy editorials from the Star on the benefits of the
streetcar. And there are 10,000 more people living downtown than were living there 12 years ago. So the worker thing is bad, Crosby. I agree with you. But the residential population downtown, which means more people caring about downtown, I wrote about that 15, 20 years ago. That's the key, is having more people live downtown. Now, hopefully, that will help with Power and Light and other things, which I agree with you. There's some of those have been oversubsidized.
Gwen, it seems like most of the development we read and hear about is apartment building.
Yeah, I mean, but that's because of the demand, the population density increasing downtown, and that's great. But that is also subsidized development, those apartment buildings. I think the other thing to note because of this study, I think it's quite timely that it comes out now when there's a movement to get a petition signed to stop expansion without a vote
a study. If you go into the details of this, it's not a study at all. It's the economic development.
And the other thing about it, too, is it's still important to note that the streetcar, it came on to support existing development. It didn't spawn this, it didn't start out with the streetcar to bring this development. There was development, then a streetcar that might help improve development afterwards. But you won't see streetcars spurring development in blighted communities.
Well, this initiative campaign that's underway, Steve, is to require a citywide vote if the streetcar line is to be extended. Do you agree with that concept?
No, even just to plan it. Remember, that's what it says.
Right. Obviously, in Missouri, if you have a tax proposal, you have to put it to the voters. These are some people who are just anti-progress.
Yeah, but let me ask you this. Let me confine it to a geographic area like was done with downtown.
Remind everyone, it passed along the South Western Corridor, over 61%. Crosby, I have a picture I'll send you, a 2003 aerial picture of downtown, and it's a ghost town. It's nothing but parking lots, old buildings, strip joints, Halloween, whatever the ghost town, whatever they call
haunted
houses.
The good old days.
Now, did that just happen? Or do you think possibly, not unlike the Erie Canal, that the government might have had something to do with that? I mean, how did we go from 6,000 people to 20,000 people that building?
I'm in favor of some targeted development dollars. No, I don't say it's all or nothing. Never said that. And I've supported a downtown development variety. The library raised a lot of private money. I supported the Power and Light District. I supported the Sprint Arena. However, you have to make some sense out of this and have some cost benefit. And if it's going to about real economic development, it has to be about jobs.
All right, it is time now for Roast and Toast, where the Ruckettes give a pat on the back or a kick in the pants to people and events in the news. We start tonight with Yale.
Well, this is a roast to UMKC and its Chancellor Leo Morton, who allowed a small controversy to erupt into a huge one about its rankings. The Star found some problems last year. At that time, UMKC could have said, whoa, these are problems. We're going to correct them. We'll take care of it. Instead, they got defensive and said they said it didn't happen. And now we fast forward to 7-8 months later, we find out that, the worst thing about hiding a controversy is it can explode in your face, and it did, and it hurt UMKC's reputation.
And I'd like to offer a toast on the same subject, UMKC. I'd like to toast Henry Block, who used the most important word in this controversy, and its integrity. UMKC avoided doing the right thing for too long. Their integrity is in question. Henry Block said that should be the key to this, and it should be the key for UMKC going forward. Thank you, Henry, for reminding us what's important.
Well, I'm still so depressed about the Super Bowl outcome that I've got to roast Seattle Seahawks coach Pete Carroll for making the worst call in Super Bowl history and robbing his young and talented team of the opportunity to repeat as Super Bowl champions. What in the world was he thinking? You know what? Thinking had nothing to do with it.
Well, this is a ro-toaster. I'm not sure roast or toast, but from what I said, it would be a toast. It's crazy season has started in the Republican Party. It's my favorite time of the year as we approach the presidential season as candidates begin to try to win the Tea Party faction of the Republican Party. The anti-Jonas Salk faction has already now spoken about vaccinations. We have a senator saying people shouldn't have to wash their hands before restaurant workers before they serve food. It should be optional. It kind of explains the Republican Party obsession with opposing Obamacare. Makes you wonder if they really don't care if people get sick or get diseases.
And finally, a toast to Jimmy the Groundhog, who showed the proper disrespect for the yearly Groundhog Day ceremony he was subjected to in Sun Prairie, Wisconsin. Take a look at this.
He says that he didn't see a shadow. It'll be an early spring. And thank you, Jimmy.
Yes, Jimmy bit the mayor's ear. His handler said the rodent was probably hungry because he had not yet eaten breakfast. The mayor called the whole incident eerie. And that is Ruckus for this week. Back next Thursday at 7 o'clock. Now, on behalf of the panel and the crew, I'm Mike Shanin saying thanks very much for watching us and good night.
Production funding for Ruckus has been provided by Fred and Lou Hartwig. And viewers like you. Thank you.